We actually view AI as the single most transformational technology over the last 50 years.
Today, everyone and even their cat knows about OpenAI and ChatGPT. But in reality, many more powerful applications of AI exist. Let's face it, the most valuable processes are actually not chatbots. And today, I would like to introduce one very promising AI startup. It's called Aleph Alpha. And surprisingly, not so many people actually heard about them, but you definitely should.
I think that within our lifetime, we will have technology that is AGI, meaning that it is superior to human in everything that creates value.
Aleph Alpha is developing LLMs in a way similar to GPT models, and they are quite famous in the academic scene. They've published some of the most important papers in the field, and they've logged several breakthroughs. They've even built this one AI system, which is, according to their CEO, Jonas Andrulis, can be considered conscious. And I will talk more about this later on in the video. But just imagine, all of this has happened even before the ChatGPT moment 1 year ago.
Our mission is technological sovereignty towards AGI or towards super intelligence. We started in 2019, I left Apple, and we started building language models before GPT-3 was out, and we went from there. We invented a bunch of stuff that, like multimodality, for example. But really, our goal is to help humanity reach the next era.
They are based in Europe, in Germany, and they are crazy visible in the European AI scene. They've managed to raise the biggest AI funding round in Europe ever. And they've got investments from Bosch, SAP, Intel, and many other companies. And I bet now you're thinking, what is their secret sauce?
Our sweet spot is not a chatbot. Our sweet spot is in manufacturing, in like medical workflows, in legal workflows, right? Where it's very complex, it's very specific, and you need a lot of tools to understand and to orchestrate the output. And that's a very different use case than basically asking ChatGPT to write a poem for your mother's birthday or something like that.
They're developing a family of LLMs called Luminous, and they keep innovating on this front.
So Luminous, our family of models, those are models up to 300 billion parameters. One of the main differences is that they're trained in 5 languages natively. That makes them somewhat good at non-English languages in comparison. And then there's another difference is that we had multimodality 2 years ago. So we kind of invented multimodality, we published and open sourced the method, and we've been doing this for a long time. And GPT-4 now has multimodality as well, but we had it 2 years ago. And something that we also invented that just now at NeurIPS presenting the paper is explainability. So built into our models is a method that can show you for everything the model completes, where this is coming from, why the model thinks, in quotes, that this is a good answer.
One of the main problems, even with the most powerful AI models, is that it turned into a sort of a black box, which is very hard to interpret. Someone may think that since it has come from a chatbot, it must be right. But that's not enough anymore, and someone has to take responsibility for this result. Of course, when we are talking of chatbots, this might be not so critical, but when we are working with legal or with medical records, this is in fact critical. Aleph Alpha is now invented a new technology, which helps us to comprehend how a model ends up with a particular result. And this allows us to trust the result. In case you're wondering why not everyone is talking about Aleph Alpha yet, is that because their products are mostly B2B, not B2C like OpenAI, for example? This means Aleph Alpha is mostly focusing on the services which it provides to other companies. Of course, Aleph Alpha has their own data center, mostly built of NVIDIA GPUs. But they also use GraphCore chips, another startup you should know about, as I previously talked about them on my channel. As we are now in the midst of the ongoing AI boom, there are many promising AI tech startups you may like to invest. Through Link2, you can invest in some of the most promising AI tech startups I've covered in depth on my channel, such as Cerebrus. It's a US-based startup building powerful AI chips and supercomputers used for training large language models. Their chips proven to be worthy competitors to NVIDIA GPUs and even outperform them on some of the benchmarks. And the potential here is enormous. In addition to Cerebrus, through Link2, you can invest in other leading AI startups I've talked about, like Lightmatter, Astera Labs, Samba Nova, Spark Cognition, and others. If you're interested in investing in the future of artificial intelligence, consider starting your private equity portfolio today using the link below. By using code Anastasia500, you will receive a discount $500 off your first investment. And the code is valid 30 days only. Thank you, Link2, for sponsoring this video. What's so interesting? Apart of LLMs and reinforcement learning, Aleph Alpha is running other projects as well. And recently, they've developed this one AI system, which is, according to their CEO, Jonas Andrulis, can be already considered as conscious. And this, of course, highly depends on the definition of this complex concept. How do you define consciousness? But check this out.
So I would argue that we already have conscious AI systems. So we build an agent that was navigating a complex simulated world, was doing this together with partners, so that like multiple agents that were collaborating in this environment, and they were built in a way where they have a world model. So their understanding of the world is like trained as a world model. So what we had there was an agent that had a world model that was planning according to this world model. And this world model contained himself and the relationship and interdependencies between the agent and the world, right? So the world model, the agent was planning himself, but also the world and their interdependencies and certain actions and outcomes and how they relate to the goal of the agent. I would argue that this is consciousness. Of course, here in a very primitive world, right? It's a very simple agent and the simulated world is very primitive. But consciousness, I would argue, is nothing else than that, a sense of self, a understanding that you are yourself and that you are in this environment and thinking and planning yourself forward in that environment and then having certain desirable outcomes and certain undesirable outcomes.
That's, of course, just one definition of consciousness. Consciousness as awareness. Awareness of yourself, your thoughts, the world around you. And according to this definition, it seems to work. Let me know what you think in the comments. But of course, consciousness is a very complex concept, and there are numerous definitions of it. So if you're interested, we discussed this with Nick Bostrom in one of my previous videos. Over the Christmas break, I was catching up on research papers. And there is this one new paper called From Google Gemini to OpenAI QStar. It's a pretty good summary of the most pivotal moments in recent AI history. And they discuss here some essential architectures and a recent paradigm shift, like a mixture of experts, which is one of the ways to approach the scalability of AI models and in general reduce the inference time. But I will link it below. Just check out the paper if you're interested. However, all this reading caused me again to think of my favorite question. So, what's next? What's coming next after LLMs?
So I believe agency and I believe modularity. So agency basically is wrapped around LLMs. And the LLM itself is more or less the world model of all language. And you can use that to plan and to perceive and to evaluate. And then basically building around these LLMs and using LLMs in like an agent way, I think is incredibly powerful. And then what I also believe will break the scaling laws or will break the compute need is modularity. So basically meaning that we are currently still very much training one giant model. And if we want to have the model more capable, we just scale it up. But because the complexity between like attention is squared, right? We like this, making it bigger scales up compute need and data need a lot. And then there's always been this criticism saying that it's weird that these AI systems need so much data, whether humans can create their intelligence with much less observations. And I think one way we could make it's much more efficient is to break it down so that we don't train the whole transformer, the whole system, and just kind of have a gradient through all the parameters with every step. But we do have small sets, small components, small subnetworks that we can select and that we can train individually with like local learning or partial learning. We already see that to some extent in the sense that like GPT-4 or the new Mistral mixture of expert model is already modular. I mentioned it earlier, our multimodality is already modular. It's already like using adapters. So I would expect that we'll see a lot more of that in the future.
One of the main principles Aleph Alpha is advocating for is sovereign AI. By this point, it seems like the world in 50 years from now might be built by AI. And we will have a problem if all the AI systems being built with some inherent bias.
We already see this with the current like chatbots in the sense that every answer you're getting from ChatGPT is very Californian. And that's fine, right? That's probably a lot better than the Chinese version, but still, there are some controversial questions are answered the way the provider of the model, the provider of the service wants them to be answered. And I think that's really critical. That's really something where in there's so much different cultures, there's so much different perspectives on life and different companies that have different goals. And I don't think I should force all the world to suffer from my dry German humor, right? So I think everybody should be able to understand and shape things based on their own values.
How Aleph Alpha is approaching this? When they're training their models, they're training it towards usefulness. They're fully focused on technology, just like me. They put less emphasis on making it to behave in a certain way and focusing more on building a useful model, which is transparent and controllable, which is so cool. I certainly buy into this idea. And of course, it's pretty clear that it's easier for Aleph Alpha to pursue this path because they're working B2B, they're working with enterprises. And easier means also cheaper, so they can focus more on other aspects. And that's much harder for companies like OpenAI because they have also B2C products and they have to take responsibility for children who might be using ChatGPT. Now, have you seen some of the recent tweets from OpenAI employees saying, brace yourself, AGI is coming? Let me know, how do you feel about that? Are you excited or a major key to enabling this dream of AGI is likely to be multimodality? And this is somehow intuitive. It's exactly what happens with our brain when it receives inputs from various domains, such as vision, voice, feelings. Actually, training an AI system on multiple inputs, on multiple modalities, such as vision and text, results in a positive transfer. They call it positive transfer across domains. And what we see, AI trained in vision is actually getting better at writing text. And this has a great promise. And of course, as we are getting closer to AGI, one question to think about is how to align such a general intelligence. And one of the ways could be adding emotions as a separate modality. You know, we evolved as mammals, and emotions are fundamental, essential to our survival. So we can feel fear or joy, and fear helps us to cope with threats, and joy helps us to reinforce social connections. So when we're thinking about alignment of AGI, one of the approaches could be adding emotions as a modality. Let me know what you think in the comments. Now, apart of Aleph Alpha, there are other AI startups I plan to keep an eye on in 2024. First of all, Mistral AI. Mistral is developing open source AI models. The startup was founded less than a year ago by former DeepMind and Meta employees. And they're already backed by US giants, Nvidia and Salesforce. And by now, it has already become a unicorn. Another AI startup to keep an eye on is AI21 Labs from Israel. They're building generative AI tool similar to ChatGPT for enterprises. From the US-based startup Sin, I will definitely keep an eye on Cohere, Anthropic AI, which are always getting what they want, just like OpenAI, and Scale AI. The last one is pretty unique. They're working with enterprises on training and labeling their own AI software. And they've also worked with Biden administration to help develop an AI system to work on classified US government network. Let me know which AI startups, in your opinion, are worth watching in 2024 in the comments. Last year was an exciting year in AI. Some of the big moments were the release of GPT-4, Claude 2, and Google's release of Gemini, which turns out to be quite controversial. I'm sure technological progress will only accelerate in 2024, and we are likely to see the explosion of multimodalities. For me, it will be interesting to watch what will happen with investments in AI. Because last year, $100 million rounds in AI became routine, a norm. But will this trend and all the excitement and FOMO around AI continue in 2024? I'm looking forward to reading all your comments, and this would make me very, very happy if you can share this video on your social media or with your friends or family. Thank you so much. With that, I wish you a wonderful 2024 and see you in the next video. Ciao.